All right, well, again, thank you all for joining. This is our first of our weekly dynamic thinking webinars for CNC Software Mastercam. My name is Chad Chmura. I'm an applications engineer at Mastercam. I've been there for about 7 years now, working in the applications department. Basically means I'm the guy who gets to play on the machines and cut chips and test all this stuff out so that nobody else has to test it out themselves. What I want to talk about today is primarily Mastercam for SolidWorks, or it's only Mastercam for SolidWorks. I'm actually going to turn off my webcam just so we don't have so much lag here. And so this is kind of targeted to people who are just looking at Mastercam for SolidWorks, or just kind of getting into it, some of the basic functionalities that Mastercam for SolidWorks offers. So this is Mastercam 2021 inside of SolidWorks 2020. And what we're going to do today is just do a little demonstration to show how Mastercam for SolidWorks takes advantage of the model associativity inside of SolidWorks. So if you're a current Mastercam user, you know, one thing that you don't have access to is working inside of an assembly file like we have here with this optical mount file. So this is an assembly file with a subassembly that is the fixture setup. And the big advantage of using Mastercam for SolidWorks is the associativity with these models, that, you know, basically anytime something can change in the model, the Mastercam toolpaths update to reflect these changes. And something that Mastercam standalone is able to do is this topic of region chaining. So what I'm going to do is build a quick 2D dynamic toolpath. And we're going to machine a couple features using 2D dynamic. One thing that's pretty interesting right off the bat for a standard Mastercam user is the fact that right now I have the opportunity to choose a new tool plane. What I want to do is machine this right side face of this part here that I have highlighted. My tool plane, though, is currently showing the backside. So I can actually toggle through here and find which Mastercam plane, I think it's Mastercam left, or that I want to use to program this operation. And now I have that active tool plane if I didn't, you know, remember to change that coming into the interface. So what I want to do is basically machine this little shoulder here from the outside in with a dynamic tool path. And I do not want to gouge this this boss that sits up here. So what I'm going to do is select a machining region. And there's a lot of different ways of doing this. So I'm just going to kind of breeze through this first one here. And select a couple solid edges. One thing that Mastercam for SolidWorks will do is automatically propagate your selection along tangencies. So if I select these two edges here, you'll notice they're completely separate disjoint entities. If I select the option to project those to a tool plane, the Mastercam for SolidWorks selection will actually pass a single chain into Mastercam. So we see here, this is just one complete loop, even though it was two disjoint selections. And that's going to be my machining region. So now if I go in and let's just set up a quick linking parameter here just so the preview shows up in the right spot. If I take and look at the preview chain, the red area is going to be what we try to machine. The yellow boundary signifies a boundary that the tool is not allowed to cross over. So right now what this tool is going to do is helix into this material and machine this entire window with no knowledge of this boss that sticks up here. And so from this point, I can actually take in and make some changes. For example, we obviously don't want to machine this lug that sits up here. So if I say I want to avoid it, I can say create an avoidance region, avoid this. So Mastercam, so SolidWorks passes an edge into the chaining manager, which is hosted by Mastercam. This is the chain of our avoidance area. Now, if I preview this again, we see now that I'm not going to machine this lug off. However, this outer boundary here is actually an open air boundary. So what I want this tool to do is come from the outside into this material without a helix. Because right now, if we helixed into this little pocket here, we'd never be able to fully reach these sharp corners, and we'd leave a zero thickness skin on the outside of the shoulder. So now I can actually go in and say, create an air region. And this is what's really cool about Mastercam for SolidWorks is the fact that I can select one edge anywhere and it will propagate that selection along currently along the tool plane. I can say just propagate along tangent edges. And this is a full 3D selection. You can see it kind of rides up the edge of this fillet here. It's not just a 2D 2D plane. And I think, so you'll see here, it just sends a 2D chain into Mastercam. And now if I do the preview, we see that this little blue area here signifies open air. So the tool is able to plunge into the open air and dynamically rough machine this shoulder off. And I want to set this up quickly with an 8mm bullnose end mill. I want a machine right up against the walls for now, just for the sake of demonstration. And just set up a couple quick links. Let's just get this up to something a little higher than the edge of the part. And now what we see is a pretty clean dynamic roughing toolpath that is really easy to select. And what the cool thing about this is these edges that we selected are fully live inside of SolidWorks. So anytime something changes with one of these selections, the toolpath will reflect that change. So let's do another one. And this time we're going to go into this back pocket. So if I say I want to select the Mastercam top tool plane, so that's good for me here. And the machining region is just going to be a pocket this time. So I want to select, you can see using that tangent propagation, it automatically selects all of those edges. And now if I do a preview, we see this, as expected, a nice red window that we're going to be roughing. 8mm bullnose end mill. And we'll grab a couple of quick key points off this part just to select some depths. I think we want something around 22mm for our depth, and our top of stock is going to be up here. So call it 35, and we'll just leave those two parameters there. And so the cool part about this is, all right, so we have a plain, nice, clean 2D dynamic roughing operation. Well, one thing that happens a lot when you're working inside of SolidWorks and Mastercam for SolidWorks is you work a lot with the engineers who are maybe making changes to these parts on the fly. So let's say we have an engineer who's having a hard time deciding how he wants the back of this part to look. And if this engineer goes in and edits this part and he says, oh, you know what? There was a rib back here that I cut off. There's a little cut extrude here. If I roll that back, the rib comes back. And now if I go back into the assembly file, which is where the toolpaths live, we notice that the Mastercam toolpath has been marked dirty. And this engineer may not even be a Mastercam guy. He might just be messing around in here without any knowledge of Mastercam toolpaths. But with the right selection, all he has to do is regenerate that toolpath, and now it reflects this nice new clean pocket, because this is a tangent edge that propagates that new selection all the way around. And again, we could do this with a finished toolpath, with a roughing toolpath. So the associativity inside of Mastercam for SolidWorks is extremely powerful. One other example that we have for that is if we did something inside of a mold style part. So this is a key fob mold, and the way this mold is constructed is, you know, SolidWorks has some really cool tools for splitting mold cavities in half and maintaining a link back to the original model. So if we look at the construction of this mold cavity, there's actually a cavity feature that is referencing the model of the key fob. So something that makes Mastercam for SolidWorks extremely powerful is the fact that I can select this feature in the history tree as machining geometry. So if I build an equal scallop finishing toolpath, you know, with traditional means, we'd basically be going in here and clicking 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you know, faces, or we could window select it. The problem with window selecting is if you add faces or add holes or things to this pocket, those will not be added to your selection automatically. But if I come in here and I select cavity, let's turn on feature selection, cavity. And then I'll actually grab these two faces here just because I don't want the tool to fall into those. Now, anytime this cavity feature changes, the toolpath will reflect that update. So again, let's just give ourselves some little containment boundary here. And this toolpath should come together pretty quickly. I just need to set up stock to leave, which for you Mastercam users, if you click this reset stock values button, it will take your default stock values and zero them out, which is extremely handy for finished tool paths. That way you don't have to type in zero twice. I'm going to create a tool. We'll just make a quick 1/8 inch ball end mill. And I believe I should be all set. So let's generate this tool path. We'll let the step over just be its default setting. So what we're going to get is a equal scallop finished tool path. Any second. There it is. So you can see it's, you know, this may or may not be the way I want my final tool path to live. The main thing I want to show you is the way that this toolpath reflects changes in the model. So this toolpath is done. Let's say the Mastercam programmer leaves and says, all right, we're done. We're ready to run this thing. Well, that engineer comes back in and says, oh, I don't really like the way that this key fob has two pockets. I'm going to have a hard time deciding which one to put my key ring in. So he goes in and says, okay, well, let's say because this cavity is reflecting the key fob model in the assembly level, if he comes in and says, I want to right click and replace a component, I can replace the key fob component, and I want to make sure to replace all instances within this assembly with the key fob version 2. And key fob version 2 has a couple changes to it. All right, that all looks good. So now you'll see we have one single pocket, and also our Mastercam toolpath has been marked dirty. Well, normally that would be kind of a scary situation for somebody who's not a Mastercam programmer. But if this guy, you know, all he knows is how to regenerate a toolpath, he can regenerate it and the toolpath comes in completely cleanly, just a quick generation. And now this toolpath reflects the single pocket inside of this key fob mold. So with this example, for you could basically select, you know, you could go even deeper and build a an OptiRough roughing toolpath and have a couple of finishing operations. And essentially, you can replace whatever component lives inside of this mold cavity and simply regenerate the toolpath. And as long as you've got your toolpath set up in a way that is flexible, you could basically just find and replace your mold pocket with anything you'd like. And one other quick little example I want to show is this keyed footing boss. This is a really good example of something that we machined in our manufacturing lab for a dynamic machining demonstration. And what we're going to do with this thing is, you know, really this is all about using that that region chaining. This part was basically designed around using region chaining. So we'll just do this one more time just to show a little bit of the functionality. If we go in and do a dynamic mill toolpath and say we want to machine this pocket here. So let's do that. And the first thing we have to do here is select our machining region. Lots of different ways we can do that. One thing we don't want to do is select this face, because this face is going to return two chains to Mastercam as machining regions. So this Mastercam is going to think these are two different pockets. So selecting the face isn't the way to go here. What we want to do is select a single edge. And in this case, tangent propagation doesn't do it for us. You know, I could go in and select all these edges manually, but we also have the option to propagate along tool plane, which is really great for selecting flat loops. So the chain now that Mastercam gets is a single flat chain. And let's just make sure we've got a good tool selected. Linking parameters should be pretty good already. So just to make sure, I can click preview chains. And what's nice about this is we can see what we're going to get in the toolpath before we even generate it. But also we have the ability to preview this toolpath while we leave the interface up. So you can see what I was talking about before with the helix pocket, where it enters what Mastercam thinks is a closed pocket. However, we're not going to machine over this shoulder here, so we're going to leave a skin on this wall. And also, this pocket, for example, let's say this pocket was already machined. We need to give Mastercam a little more information and say, oh, well, you can just drop right in here and you can just run with that. So let's say we'll add an air region. And this time I'm just going to select, we'll just select manually. We'll grab all these. So there's an air region. Those six edges in SolidWorks are passed into Mastercam as a single chain. We can preview the chain. We see a nice blue pocket there. We can turn the preview chain off, and preview the toolpath, and this generates the toolpath while we're in the interface. So now let's backplot this. So we can see the tool is going to come in, drop into that pocket that was already machined, and dynamically work its way out from the center. One final issue, though, is, again, we have to tell the tool it's allowed to pass over this edge. And we can easily just jump back in and give it a couple other quick air regions. And the reason why I'm doing this with manual selection, well, I guess I can leave it on propagate along tool edges or tangent edges, is if it propagates along a tool plane, it's going to think this entire outside boundary is an air region, which we don't want, because that's going to allow Mastercam to machine off these upper tiers of this part. So it's always good to go into the chain manager and preview what chains are being passed into Mastercam for the selection, which these two look good. Preview chains will show the tool is allowed to plunge out here and gradually work its way into the part. And if we regenerate this, we get a nice 2D dynamic toolpath that probably starts outside of the part depending on our settings. And this was a really cool toolpath that we ran just to show basically the way that dynamic milling is faster than traditional roughing techniques. And what's cool here is as the cutter approaches this pocket, it sees it breaks into that pocket, and now it can skip all of that air and get right into machining material. So not one second of this toolpath is wasted machining open air. So that's really all I had prepared to show you all today. If there are any questions, please type a question into the question pane and I'd be happy to answer it. I think Mastercam for SolidWorks is a piece of software that's really, you know, underutilized. I think there is so much power here, you know, taking advantage of SolidWorks selection capabilities and its CAD capabilities, that when you pair that with Mastercam toolpaths, these are extremely powerful. First question is that someone doesn't have sound, so we may have to just this will be recorded and posted onto the internet, so we'll have to send up a follow-up email where that link is going to be. So if there are any other questions. All right, well, thank you all for joining. Next week we're going to have another Mastercam for SolidWorks and Mastercam together demo, where we're going to be running the deburr toolpath in 3-axis and 5-axis. So definitely join us again next week for that. And thank you all for joining.